Greetings, citizens. Everyone, hello. We are back again for another podcast of madness. Joining me this week is the irreverent, the immortal, the some say he absorbs knowledge in the process of his sleep through some sort of weird Star Citizen-related osmosis. No one knows how. His name, of course, is Nehkara. We revere to him. We revere him as the Space Pope.
Hello. That's all you get.
Joining me again and doing an amazing time producing, thank you very much, is from the base, Nitro Typat, inventor of the Typat. And our special guest, again from the base, longest running serving DJ. Why have you got to run and serve? I don't know. But Zhane.
Well, hi.
You have a show yourself on the base Friday nights?
I do. I am DJ and manager over at the base. And short of Rico and Relum, I don't think anybody has been at the base longer. I don't know if that's a good thing. I don't know why I'm proud of that, but, you know, there it is.
Wow. So we've got a fair old bit to go over this week, so we might as well get stuck in with things, shall we?
Sounds good to me.
Yeah. Okay, and first of all, big news. Where should we start? Do you want to go with the hurricane, or do you want to go with the 2.6.1?
Yes.
2.6.1.
2.6.1. Okay, so 2.6.1 came out. We'll be calling Spectrum a part of 2.6.1.
Yeah, I believe so.
Okay, so that was part of 2.6.1. Some bug fixes, some changes. What do we think so far? Has anyone actually played it yet?
I have not.
I have. 2.6.1 is remarkably stable, I'll give it that. And a good patch all around. The Mega Map's awesome. I've used Spectrum a little bit. It's pretty solid first release and pretty impressive platform. I can't wait to see what else they can do with it.
It's very early in the development, isn't it? So
yeah, very. I mean, if you just look at what they want to do with it, they have a lot more features they want to add to the forums. They still want to add voice. They need to add mobile app. There's a lot of work to be done. Well, and you can tell by the version numbering, it's only version 0.3.
Zhane, Nitro, either of you delved into any features of 2.6.1?
I logged into Spectrum and, like, put a couple of rocket ship emotes into the base chat room that was automatically there, and I haven't used it since. I'm excited for the eventual voice integration with the game, and I hope the way they implement that is compelling enough to pull people away from TeamSpeak and Discord, because I would like it to be that compelling. I don't know if that's going to happen. As for the rest of the current feature set, I don't go to the official RSI forums or chat room anyway. I'm not going to start now.
Yep, yeah, true. That's fair.
I do expect that Relay will eventually move ourselves over there, but not soon. We definitely need a mobile app before that's even possible.
So yeah. Soon.tv.
Discord is our home.
Yeah, and so many larger organizations, and I think a lot of even smaller organizations, like, have been doing their own thing for literally years now. I don't see them being compelled to give up, you know, their forum system, all their other out of game tools that they've been developing themselves for years, and say, hey, let's use this thing now. I don't think that's realistic.
I don't necessarily think it's realistic until the game's out. I think some of the integration with the game will make it fairly compelling, but for a while anyway, it's going to be sort of work in progress.
Talking of Spectrum, like, eventually long term, do you think communication wise, for instance, we will see the ability to communicate from outside of the game into the game?
Oh yeah, that's what Spectrum is designed for. It absolutely, 100%. Even right now. Well, voice and text will both be transmittable between the two in and out of the game.
You think you can check the game's forums from your Mobi Glass in the game?
I don't know. I think so, because that's what they've talked about. But, I mean, to me, it's a little bit immersion breaking, but, you know, it is what it is. Sometimes you have to prioritize the game over the immersion. But even with that, they even talked in ATV about how they're really connecting Spectrum directly into the game. So you will be able to see the location of your friends anywhere inside the game universe, right? Like, that part's already more or less done. I think that's pretty cool.
It would be pretty cool to say, you know, be able to communicate in voice or even just text from an app on my mobile or tablet when I'm traveling somewhere or whatever with someone who is directly playing a game still. That could be quite cool.
I'm also interested in down the road eventually being able to like track, you know, maybe you've got something waiting to be delivered to you in the game. You'd just be able to pick up your phone or your tablet and like check the status of that delivery or what have you. Maybe you've got some NPCs crewing a ship somewhere else. If that turns out to be a thing, we don't really know if that's going to be a thing, but because one of the things that I found potentially exciting from ATV was they specifically mentioned they were working on multiple client connections, being able to connect to Spectrum from multiple sources simultaneously, like the web and your phone or the game and your phone or whatever. I don't know if any of you guys have played the current World of Warcraft expansion, but there's a phone app for Legion that lets you manage some of the more like Facebook game kind of aspects that are part of WoW now. You can do your little garrison missions and stuff from your phone, but you can't do that while you're logged into the game. It is one login. So if I can't be like, you know, raiding or something and check my missions on my phone. I have to actually log out of the game, which is super annoying.
Yeah. Yeah. They said that was one of the big challenges, but they seem to have dealt with it already. Mm-hmm. So
in an ideal world, an app for the mobile devices would basically be your Mobi Glass in game. Exactly the same. If you could just use your mobile device as a Mobi Glass, because then you could even integrate it into the game as a augmented reality in a way. I suppose like the cheapest way to do augmented reality is have your phone, your tablet as an input device that's intuitive to the game.
Well, I've already got a Mobi Glass logo wallpaper on my phone, so I'm a step ahead.
You'll get it, yeah. I'd really like to see if they could implement something like Elcars.
I got to take a second to welcome Sean Noonan. He's in Twitch chat, and he is from Foundry 42 UK.
Oh, hi.
Hey, Sean.
What does he do?
He's a senior designer at Foundry 42 UK, level designer.
So what's
probably
he working on?
Squadron. Oh, okay. Probably Squadron. Can you show us Squadron, Sean? I'm thinking no, but
I mean, it's worth the ask. It's worth the ask. Mm-hmm. Hurricane.
Mm-hmm.
Hurricane has been revealed, is on sale.
It's a very
over here in the step. Well, over here in the UK, if you buy it, melt it or go for whatever non-Warbond version, that is £168, $210. Warbond version, $153, $60, $192. I think it's a bit cheaper in US and Canada, wasn't it, Nehkara?
Yeah, it's $175 US for the normal version. The Warbond is
$160.
It's just a little cheaper than the Super Hornet.
What do we think? What do you think? Thoughts? Hurricane?
Gorgeous ship.
Give me a torrent of thoughts.
Okay, it's a gorgeous ship. It looks very pewy.
Yeah.
Lots of pew.
What I was talking about it yesterday, I called it a very angry-looking tortilla chip. I stand by that, but I also like the design. Yeah. My only gripe with the design is the front guns are so far forward, they're just dangling off the nose of the ship. It's got those like double swept wings. I don't know why they didn't tuck the guns like into the wings, kind of in a bullpup configuration. I think that would look nicer, but I'm not a designer.
Aren't those guns on the front retractable?
I have no idea.
They don't look retractable to me.
I think they're hard mounted on gimbals.
They're pretty.
I thought the nose, the ones on the nose.
Yeah,
I thought they were. I might have been tripping because I'm getting over a cold, so I'm pumped up full of all sorts of vitamins at the moment. But I might have either imagined or seen a concept image where the guns retracted back into the frame.
There was one of the images I think where it like either had really small guns mounted there or no guns mounted there.
Yeah, I'm looking at that image right now. I don't know if they retract back or I'm not sure if they're retracted back or they're just missing, but it doesn't look like there's a lot of room up there for them to retract. They're pretty big guns and the ship's not very big.
Can we talk about the turret for a second? Because the turret has as much firepower as my saber does.
Oh yeah, that turret is unfreaking real, man.
This ship, I believe, is the definition of a glass cannon. It's you're either going to kill things really quickly or you're going to die
very quickly.
It is. And actually, one of the things is that they tell you not to fly alone with it because what you need is a meat shield. This ship would pair perfectly with like a Super Hornet or even just a Hornet or even a heavier armored ship that isn't necessarily meant for combat, as long as like the Terrapin, as long as the Terrapin could absorb some damage while the Hurricane just rips them apart from afar.
And it would be an excellent launched fighter for a larger ship that can carry one in a hangar. I think it's the size appropriate for a lot of the ships of that scale.
Yeah, absolutely. It's not very big. Just looking at the exact size here, it's only 22 meters long. It's about the same size as the Hornet.
Yeah.
Very similar.
So any ship that's equipped to launch fighters that are larger than snub fighters, it should be compatible with, I would think.
You could put one in a Polaris.
Yeah.
Just saying.
I did think it was really interesting the lore that they had around it. Basically, the ship was created because they were having a terrible time chewing through the T'Varan defenses in the Second T'Varan War. And it was actually retired after the war, that Second War. And they didn't bring it back until until basically 50 years before present in Star Citizen because of the Vanduul threat. It was resurrected as a design. I just thought that was kind of interesting. It's neat for them to really integrate it into the game's lore.
Yeah, I did like that. My big concern with and I'm not a fighter guy. Like none of the ships I own would be considered combat ships. I'm all trade and industry stuff. But My concern about it is that it leans so heavily on the turret, and this kind of leads to a larger issue. Turret gameplay is not fun. Is not functional. A complete overhaul of the way turrets play is going to need to happen for a ship like that to be fun or functional.
This is true, but they've already admitted as such and have already talked about the fact that, 3.0 is sort of their aim for fixing turrets because they need item system 2.0 to work first. By the way, I'm looking through the brochure right now. Those front guns do retract. They don't come inside. They don't come inside the ship, but they're actually on rails and they slide back alongside the body.
Oh, excellent! Like the front guns on the saber.
Yeah. So they just basically slide back alongside the body, so they're not so exposed.
Inner 80s me is screaming with joy. Excellent news.
One thing I did find kind of interesting with this is it's supposed to be an anvil ship, but I didn't get much of an anvil vibe from it.
Really?
It seemed very much like it had aspects from a lot of different manufacturers. Like the wings really look very Origin to me.
Mm. The kind of swept, curved
wings.
It is the shape of the Anvil logo. Just it's a triangle.
This is true.
What did you think of when you saw those wings?
What did I think of?
When you first saw the wings, were you reminded of any other ship from any other sci-fi franchise?
Well, immediately when I saw those wings, I thought of the 300i, honestly.
Actually, yeah.
I thought of the 300 series.
If you take the guns out of the Hornet, or I mean, at least the old Hornet, because I remember the old Hornet wings actually swept under like that. They're not like that anymore, are they?
They do. Super Hornet or Hornet lands, the wings retract.
I meant on the old Hornet model, like back when it was in hangar, the wing was like flat, and then once it got to the end, it would go down and then come back, and where the gun was at.
I'm pretty sure that isn't in there anymore.
Yeah, I don't think it's like that anymore.
No. It's not really a criticism. It's just really the way the wings are shaped really sort of harkened back to a lot of the origin designs for me.
Mm-hmm.
So my first thought when I saw it was, hey, those wings look like an origin ship. It is interesting, though, because that might simply be an artifact of the fact that it's a very old design. It would be what? Hundreds of years old at this point in the Star Citizen universe.
Mm-hmm.
I got, I think it was the Hornet in Wing Commander 3 and 4. I got a vague outline impression of that. Very vague, because the wings were different. But there was like the body shape. It was like a cross between that with an obese Avenger.
I definitely got the Avenger feel from it too. Definitely. I saw the Avenger bit of it right away. It almost, that's what I mean. It kind of seems like an amalgamation. It seems like an Anvil Aegis origin ship, kind of like just smashed together. But I actually really like the design, and I think that it's cool that this is very clearly not a ship for a starter pilot to fly. It needs a very skilled pilot and a very skilled gunner to be effective. It's almost important you have two people, because the pilot really will need to focus on not getting shot because it has no armor.
This is where your HOTAS user and your mouse and keyboard user will work together in sweet harmony.
Yeah, definitely.
So that's interesting. What do you think about the price of it?
I think it's reasonable. Given the prices of the other ships, I think it's reasonable.
It's certainly not something that someone who's just coming into the game should be looking at to pick up as their first ship ever.
No.
I was actually expecting it to cost a lot more.
Was expecting that as well. Yeah,
because the way it was designed in the concept art that they showed on Thursday, it was like, you know, big ship, big guns, turret on top. I was thinking, oh, it's like Vanguard sized, you know. I mean, it's not long range, so it's not self sustaining like the Vanguard is. But I was like expecting up in like the Vanguard price range, almost maybe a little bit cheaper. And then it was a lot cheaper than I expected it to be.
Thoughts, Zhane?
Okay. my thoughts on ship pricing are a little salty these days overall. But it's comparable to other similar ships, so there's not an issue there, I suppose.
I agree. I haven't bought a ship in a while, and a lot of that is part of the culprit for that is a lot of people probably aren't aware of this, but a couple of years ago, the Canadian dollar was more or less at par with the US dollar, so a $175 ship cost me $175. Mm-hmm. That is no longer the case. $175 ship now costs me
Brexit
like...
Brexit happened here.
$175 ship now costs me like $225, or even more. So, and I think that's put off a lot of Canadians from buying ships, because it's...
I'm trying to think of the last time I bought a ship. I haven't bought any new ships in forever. The last time I would have bought a ship was I picked up a merchantman during CitizenCon 15, I want to say.
Okay.
It wasn't a new ship, you know, then, but that's when I bought mine. I think the new designs are cool. I just, like, you know, I've got like $1,000 worth of ships. I'm not really in the market.
Yeah, I agree. I'm sort of in the same vein. It takes something really, really compelling for me to buy another ship. I think my last actual ship purchase was a Prospector.
I did get one of those. I can't remember if that was after 15 or not.
But I was very excited by the Prospector.
Yeah, but that said, the last few ships I've bought have all been, like, I would melt something else to get them. I haven't put new money into ships quite a long time.
Yeah, the last new ship I bought was the Terrapin, and I only paid $15 for it.
I think there's a lot of... I mean, I don't want to get into the whole the development is taking so long, because we all know it's not, but there is a certain level of concept sale fatigue, I think. Yep. People are just tired of buying new ships at this stage of development.
Yeah, and I think it's especially prominent for people like the people present here who've been into Star Citizen for a long time. I think that because based on the numbers, the concept sales are still popular. They still make money. You know, I think that there's a lot of new players who are still where we were like 4 years ago.
Right.
You know, but for a lot of the veteran backers, I think a lot of them are pretty much done buying ships unless something is incredibly compelling for them. One thing, actually, that sort of leads into I was taking a look at the numbers for this concept sale. It's doing pretty well. All things considered, it's right about the same level as the Prospector or the Endeavor concept sale, which both ended up around $1.2 million total.
That kind of surprises me because I feel like there's so many options for fighters. That's great though.
Yeah, it's good for Star Citizen. It's doing fairly well. I think a part of it is that there hasn't been a concept sale in a while, a couple months at least. I don't know. Was there a concept sale at Christmas, or was that just a ship sale?
Ship sale, I think.
Yeah, I think the last concept sale was
when was the Terrapin?
Terrapin was before the Polaris. I think the Polaris was the most recent, wasn't it?
Yeah, I think so. Because the Polaris was a holiday.
Which Citizen Con?
Sorry, actually, it looks like the... there was a concept sale at Christmas. It was the Misc Razor.
Oh, of course.
Right.
Yeah, that was a close shave. I think when it comes down to ship sales, the thing is, yeah, that there is probably a lot of fatigue from veteran backers, new backers alike. It doesn't really matter the time period, I suppose. But it works. It does bring in money, and you've got to bring in money to keep going, really. And it works. What there is nothing else really that they could put on offer and say like, here's this Star Marine helmet for sale. That's, you know, I hope something that they will never actually approach.
Right.
So that is the unfortunate side effect of all they can put on sale to make money that works is ships. If they put on merchandise, they've got to give a certain cut to manufacturers and shipping and things like that. So that I can understand that, but I can also, as a backer, understand, oh, it's another concept sale. But then I bought a Hurricane. So, It comes down to you only ever need to buy that first package of like the Mustang or the Aurora or just Squadron 42. That's all you ever need to buy. If you don't want to put in any more, then don't.
Yep.
So, yeah, try and restrain myself, really.
Oh, yeah.
Well, one of the things I've really noticed is that the underlying fundamentals of their funding is actually pretty strong right now. They didn't have any sales of any kind in January, and they still made $1.75 million. Like, that's solid without any real sale of any kind.
Now, is that normal for a month where they don't have anything going on? Or is my guess would be that would be people getting Christmas money and spending it on Star Citizen.
That's possible. In comparison, they had one really awful July. Was it last July? Yeah, it was last July. They made $800,000. Mm. Like, you know, that was a really bad month for them. I was really impressed that January there was nothing really special, and they still made a decent amount of money. February is a bit of a shorter month, but it looks like they'll be a little over $2 million for February. But, you know, like when things were particularly bad in the community, the daily funding would drop to like 10 grand a day. It's currently around 40 to 50. So pretty good.
There was no production schedule update for 2.6.2. That's what we're expecting. Was anyone actually expecting a production schedule update last night? Yeah, we were.
Yep,
you're optimistic.
I had no reason to believe there wouldn't be one. It seems like a small patch, so I thought that they would already have all their ducks in a row. But they do not have their ducks in a row. Hopefully this week they'll have their ducks in a row. At least we know what's in it now, though, because we had no idea before.
It's really
as long as they're not going quackers.
It's hard to organize ducks. They're not very cooperative.
No, not at all. It's as bad as cats. Yeah. But we actually know what's in the patch now. It's going to be polishing and balance, but also any features that they missed for 2.6.1. The only one specifically mentioned, but I'm excited for, is the multiplayer mega map. The single player one is very impressive, so I'm excited for the multiplayer version too.
I'm finding myself having a hard time getting excited about anything that isn't 3.0. Because we know it's looming out there. It's coming at some point, and it's the first time the game is actually going to be a game, in my opinion. And you know, like it's like nothing else between now and 3.0. I don't care.
So I'm going to go that direction then. I was very happy to hear this week, or in the past week or so. I'm not sure exactly when it was announced, but it seems like mining is going to be in 3.0. The prospector is basically done, and there was sort of a hint as well that the next 10 for the chairman will be discussing professions in 3.0, and it will include cargo and mining. Exciting.
Do you think that means, because previously they had said that 3.0 would have a very basic implementation of cargo where it would be, from my understanding, you know, like another game would do it where you would order some cargo and it would appear in your ship and you would fly it somewhere and click the button to unload your cargo and it would disappear. To my mind anyway, if mining is going to be a thing, that implies a more robust cargo system, because if you got to do something with the rocks.
I think it may well, like when they originally talked about that, 3.0 was coming at the end of 2016. And I think if it had, then that's the cargo system you would have got. I think with other things taking longer, building planets, although I'll come back to that, building planets, network code, and AI are their big, those are the big problems right now. Mm-hmm. I think that the other features evolve as they work on those things. I mean, the guy working on cargo isn't going to stop working on it just because networking is taking longer. So you very well might see a more robust mechanic when it comes out. But I agree with the addition of mining there, that's a higher possibility too.
They could only take the cargo system, say, to a certain degree before they can say, right, well, we can work on it, but we shouldn't do any more before we give it to players to see what the feedback is, to see where it needs to be improved before we steer it in a particular direction. There is that as a factor as well.
Yeah, but I mean, that's sort of the part that was missing, was actually being able to move cargo around. I think that part is always going to be a part of the game. So going to that point is not a big deal.
it's almost like they need to stream these objects into, say, containers.
That actually came up this week too. Object container streaming is work in progress, and it looks like their first test bed is going to be the hangar. They're going to be testing object container streaming in the hangars, which will give them some basic information about how it works in the game. So for those who don't know what it is, basically the idea is you're going to have an entire star system and you cannot render an entire star system. So you have to render objects. So basically it's actually Shiv earlier today had a great analogy. It's basically Russian nesting dolls. When you look at the base one, all you can see is the base one. But when you open it up, you can see the one inside and so on and so forth. As you get closer to an object, you can actually see what's inside of it, like a planet, for example. You can see the trees on it. But when you're far away from it, the game goes, okay, you're 2 million kilometers from this planet. You don't need to see the trees. You know? So the first implementation is going to be in the hangar, and it will probably occlude, you know, objects that are in other rooms or within your ship, for example. So that should be interesting. I also had a theory that it might be part of them trying to open the hangar doors and allowing players to fly out.
That'll be an exciting day.
I like that theory.
I think with the mega maps in and with object container streaming, they might finally be able to open the hangar doors. And that would be amazing.
Mm-hmm. Acid has a nice analogy of its level of detail for networking.
Yeah, essentially. And also for rendering. Level of detail is level of detail for rendering, but it is very notable there. One of the biggest problems besides networking in Crusader right now is their object, like their culling is pretty basic right now. You render a lot of that entire map when you're playing, mm-hmm. even though you don't need to. You can't see hardly any of it at a given time. I am going to stop briefly for a drink. Be right back.
So something like the Bengal carrier, in order for them to have this huge Bengal carrier, for you to see the whole Bengal carrier in its glory, you don't need to have the inside of the hangar rendered unless you're going to be using it, in which case you're on the Bengal hangar, in which case you don't need to see out of the Bengal carrier unless you're near the window. And so it's a very clever way for them to be able to save resources and for you to see a hell of a lot on screen without your PC catching fire or slowing down to 2 FPS, say.
Yeah, and ships that size, I mean, let's face it, it's not going to be, you know, if you're on the foredeck, it's not going to be rendering the back end of the ship for you. At least, I hope not.
It might even be able to, it should be on such level of detail that, say, it's a multi-deck ship. If you're on level one, you don't need to have level two rendered.
Yeah, if you're streaming the assets fast enough. I'm sure we've all played Unreal Engine games where, like, you walk into a room and nothing is textured for a few seconds and then suddenly everything gains detail. That's, you know, we don't want that. But.
Yeah, too many games do that.
Hello, I'm back.
Oh, hi.
Welcome back. So we also saw a little bit of the Aurora rework in progress. That was quite difficult to say. I want you to know that. Mm. Thoughts? Aurora impressions?
Rework. Wait, where was this at?
It was in ATV.
It looked like an Aurora to me.
I missed that.
They didn't really... I mean, they didn't fundamentally remake the Aurora. Yeah. It's... The details are obviously significantly improved, and Elwin Batchelor Jr. is doing it, so you know it's going to be good. They didn't fundamentally change what the Aurora is, but I definitely noticed the details are way more pronounced than they used to be. Which makes sense, because that ship is very old. So it needed some love.
It is. It's kind of beautiful in its own weird way.
It's like a
kind of. But yeah, sorry, Zhane, go ahead.
I've always kind of thought of the Aurora as like a Star Trek shuttlecraft, but less useful.
That's true.
I think that it's going to find its own little unique, bizarre uses in the universe. I mean, sometimes just having a really cheap ship will be really helpful. But I'm very curious to see what sort of place it takes in the universe.
I mean, for me, again, I'm come at the game from a more industrial, you know, kind of, I mean, I'm a guy who puts Euro Truck Simulator 2 on like his list of best games ever. So, for me, if I was going to have an, why wouldn't I just have a Hull A instead of an Aurora?
Yeah. Oh, I agree. I mean, in terms of transport, the Hull, I mean, Hull A is one thing. The Hull B is like the, is in my opinion, the perfect transport ship. It's about the same price as a Freelancer, but it actually carries much, much more. And I
could go on forever. It's actually cheaper than a Freelancer.
Yeah, a little bit. It has, like, no weapons, but it hulls a lot. And that, I actually have one of those. And, of course, for me, I'm really excited because the Hull B is designed to work in concert with the Prospector. And you can create a really cool teamwork thing going.
Getting some Truck Simulator love in the chat. I love that.
Also, I really hope they manage to finish the Hull B in time for 3.0 because I would love to see that.
Mm.
I would love to see that team play that exists, you know, or that's supposed to exist actually happen.
Yeah, it's what was it? You were meant to use the Hull A and B to load up the Hull E and D? Is that right?
Well, not kind of.
Because they can land.
They're ships of their own, but yeah, they can actually land, whereas it's significantly more difficult. Well, the other ships can't land when they're loaded. They can't take off when they're loaded, so they have to be loaded in space.
And that's where your other industrial smaller ships will always have their use.
Well, yeah, that's the thing. Like, yeah. It just can't survive an atmosphere when it's...
That kind of gives an interesting idea for a profession of just being one of the naval dockyard-type delivered, loady, jobby affairs. If you're really good at piloting, you really enjoy it, but you don't want to shoot anyone.
Yep.
You have to do complex maneuvers, be a really good pilot.
The number of possible professions you can create for yourself in Star Citizen is mind-boggling. As long as they design the game systems properly, but you know, the possibilities are endless. Honestly,
I'm still really excited for multi-crew.
You could be a guy who specializes in repairing Auroras.
You can be a guy who specializes in destroying Auroras.
You mean a Bengal carrier?
Wait, isn't that entirely what Test is? Never mind.
Yes, exactly.
That's true.
Test gaming. So should we take some questions? I'll
open it up to questions, but I thought if we start off with your edutainment section while we gather in some questions.
All right, so we got a long edutainment section this week because something very important happened this week.
Mm-hmm.
So NASA had a press conference and announced the discovery of TRAPPIST-1, which is a star system 40 light years from Earth. It is very interesting star system. It has 7 planets that we've detected so far that are all roughly the same size as Earth. It has 3 planets within its habitable zone, maybe a 4th. One of them is right on the edge. It might be too hot. It's really, really interesting because it's a very small star. Very small. It's just a little bit larger than Jupiter. So actually, I believe Crusader... No, Crusader is smaller than Jupiter. TRAPPIST 1 is only about 7% larger than Jupiter. So it's only slightly larger than a gas giant in our own system. So one of the websites, I'm a little bit nerdy about this kind of thing, as you may have noticed. One of the websites I've visited off and on throughout the years is actually called the Planetary Habitability Laboratory, which is a website maintained by the University of Puerto Rico. And they actually have a list of all of the possibly habitable exoplanets. And, you know, they added four to the list with the discovery of the TRAPPIST-1 system. There were only 45 on the list to begin with, and that's after years and years of discoveries. TRAPPIST-1e has become the second most likely planet to be habitable of all the ones that we've found so far. So this discovery was actually made in concert with a whole bunch of different telescopes. I'm going to list them off, and hopefully Nitro can keep up with me, but there's several. The first one is the Spitzer Space Telescope, which is a NASA telescope. It was launched in 2003. And it is an infrared space telescope. Basically, it's kind of interesting here is that this telescope was initially only expected to operate for like 5 years, and it's, you know, been what, 14? So still doing good science. The second one is the Paranal Observatory, and specifically the very large telescope at the Paranal Observatory. This is in Chile. This is a ground telescope, and it also contributed to this finding. And then the other two that I wanted to mention, other three that I wanted to mention, obviously the most important one is actually the TRAPPIST telescope, for which it's named. The TRAPPIST telescope actually isn't very large. It's a ground-based telescope. It's about 60 centimeters, the mirror. It's in the Chilean mountains, but it's actually a Belgian observatory. And it's an interesting little telescope, but the TRAPPIST-1 was actually the first star system that it discovered with exoplanets around it, which is why it is called TRAPPIST-1. The initial findings, they found three planets, and that was about a year ago, and then they found the additional four more recently. A lot of people have been reporting on this subject. You probably heard about it in the media, but some of the details you might not know yet. We actually don't know everything. Well, that's kind of obvious. We don't know everything about this star system. We also don't know as much as we're about to know about it either. The Kepler Space Telescope, which is incredibly famous because it is discovered, I believe, somewhere on the order of 6,000 exoplanets. The original observations that were done on the TRAPPIST-1 system were only 20 days. However, Kepler is currently actually staring at this star on its own, and its observations will be 80 days. So we're about to learn a lot more about it. Those observations actually finish next week. So we'll soon know even more. Part of that is that the last planet in that system, which is, I believe, TRAPPIST-1H. We don't actually know the orbital period of that planet with any real certainty because its orbital period's about 20 days, they think. And so they only watched it for 20 days, so they've only seen it pass by the star once. We'll know a lot more about that planet in particular, but also about all the other ones, too, with many more observations. I also found out today that the Hubble Space Telescope is already looking at TRAPPIST-1 as well, trying to see if it can get any sort of atmospheric data from these planets. And sort of the holy grail of that effort will be the James Webb Space Telescope. The James Webb, a lot of people have heard about it. It is the successor to Hubble. It will be launching next year.
I've seen the James Webb telescope in person.
Oh, that's so cool.
I was to the facility.
It's not a person, Nitro, it's a telescope.
I've seen it in telescope.
James Webb launches next October, so October 2018, aboard the Ariane 5 ECA rocket. It's like a $10 billion space telescope, roughly. Very, very expensive. It's been in development for 20 years. But its capabilities are unreal. It'll be over 100 times more powerful than the Hubble. It should be able to tell us what is in the atmosphere of these planets, which is incredible. So we will know sometime in the next probably 5 years whether or not there is oxygen, methane, water vapor in the atmospheres of the planets around TRAPPIST-1.
How far away is it? Like, how long would it take for us to, with our current level of spacecraft, to send something there? Someone has to ask.
About 700,000 years.
Get started now.
That's not so bad.
That's basically the fastest manned mission. The fastest, fastest probe we've ever had. The fastest probe we've ever created would be able to get there in about 165,000 years. Basically, we need better propulsion if we're ever going to try and get there. But, I mean, in galactic terms, it's very close. There are not a lot of stars that are closer than 40 light years.
Yeah, I mean, if there's anyone over there, they've already been getting, like, our radio waves and stuff for a while.
Yep, absolutely.
You mean they get the base?
No, they it's will. Not been operating for 40 years. But yeah. Eventually they'll get all of your shows from the base.
I did.
We're sorry.
I did see Neil deGrasse Tyson on Twitter suggest that because it was a dwarf star and there were seven planets, they must name the planets after the seven dwarves.
Yeah, I think that's a great idea. So the actual planets themselves, the first one, so actually into the way planets are named, the star is actually always considered A in a system. So the star is known as TRAPPIST-1, but also TRAPPIST-1A. So the first planet is TRAPPIST-1B. It has an orbital period of only 1.5 days. So it basically flies around its star like incredibly fast. All seven of these planets orbit inside what would be the orbit of Mercury in our system. In fact, far inside the orbit of Mercury. But because the star is so small and so cold, I mean, cold, relatively speaking, it still has these three planets within the habitable zone. So TRAPPIST-1b is an orbital period of 1.5 days. It's about 110% the radius of Earth and about 85% the mass. C is about 2.5 days, and it is about the same size as Earth, but its actual mass is about 40% more than Earth. TRAPPIST-1D, now this one's kind of interesting because it's right on the edge of the habitable zone. They think it might be too hot to have liquid water on the surface, but they're not really certain. Need way more observations of this one. It's a little planet. It's only about 40% of the mass of Earth, about 70% of its radius. Then the real ones that they're really interested in are E, F, and G, because they're all in the habitable zone. They're all roughly the same size as Earth. E is 92% Earth's radius and 62% its mass, so it'd be about 62% our gravity. F is about almost exactly the same radius as Earth and about 70% the mass. And G is a little bit larger. It's about 13% bigger than Earth and about 34% heavier. These planets are 6, 9, and 12 days in their orbital period. So again, their years are very short. And as I mentioned before, the seventh planet, we don't know a lot about it yet because we've only seen it once. Some of these other planets they've seen 30, 40 times while they were studying the system. The seventh planet has an orbital period of maybe roughly 20 days. They're not sure. And it's about 75% the size of Earth. They're not 100% certain because they've only seen it once, but they're fairly certain it's too far out to harbor liquid water. It's probably too cold. So the only thing that, like, these planets actually would have a pretty good shot at harboring life, except for one kind of nasty factor. as far as they can tell, they believe the planets might be tidally locked. And what that means is that one side of the planet always faces the star. So there would be a habitable area on the planet, on these planets in the habitable zone, but it would be right around, like in a ring, basically around the planet between the dark side and the light side of the planet. Because one side would always be light, one side would always be dark. Now, they're not 100% certain about this, though. Some articles have said for sure that they're tidally locked, but actually reading the details, they're not certain about it. They also wonder if their orbit is more like Mercury, which has what's called a spin order resonance, or a spin orbit resonance, sorry. And basically that means that most of the time one side is facing the star, but not always. Which would make it significantly more likely that there could be life on the surface. Overall, super interesting finding. Even if there isn't any life in this system, what we have learned is that Earth-like planets are not that uncommon.
Yeah, or as rare as we thought they were.
Not even close. I mean, seven in one observation of one system is like so. There has to be tons of
them. And it's so close.
And they say video games aren't realistic.
Can I ask a really dumb question? This is a really dumb question and a kind of out there question. Knowing very little about this sort of thing, if our radio waves and broadcast and stuff would have reached anyone there by this point, wouldn't it then follow that if there was anyone there broadcasting anything, we would have heard it by now?
Yes. The only thing is, though, that this has always been sort of my thought about that, is it's our understanding of the universe is pretty poor. Mm-hmm. We don't really... like maybe they communicate in some way that's completely undetectable to us. You know, it's really hard to tell. Given what the system looks like, it's kind of unlikely that there's a high order intelligence there. There might be life though, like in the order of things like bacteria or plants or things. But, if the planets are tidally locked, it puts a bit of a damper on it. It would be more difficult for things to survive there.
Right. Super exciting, though.
Super exciting. So even if, you know, and again, even if this system turns out to be barren, all it is a really interesting star system, it does tell us right away there are probably way, way, way more Earth-like planets out there that we haven't discovered. And this actually will lead me back to one that was discovered last year. And that is Proxima Centauri B. I'm sure it's faded out of people's interest a little bit because it hasn't been brought up recently. But they're one of the best candidates for life that we've found so far is a planet around Proxima Centauri, which is only 4 light years away. And it's about roughly the same size as Earth. And that one, you know, might not reach it in our lifetime, but it's once we get going fast enough, it's not that long of a trip. So I know it's coming along. I'm really excited for James Webb as well, it'll be this huge quantum leap forward in our understanding of the universe because it's such a better telescope than anything else we've ever built.
Would you say it's almost a quantum jump?
No. No. I wouldn't say that.
No.
Would you say it's out of this world?
Yes, I would. But basically, James Webb will be able to directly image planets around other star stars, and it will also be able to do what it's going to do with the TRAPPIST system, which is examine the atmospheres of these planets. The other kind of exciting thing about the Kepler observations of this system is it's very possible that there are more planets in that system beyond the 7 that we saw, because they only did observe it for 20 days. So there could be a lot more to learn coming up. Anyway, probably talked for long enough. Back to Star Citizen.
Would you say more to Luna?
No, I wouldn't say that.
No.
Oh, no. All right. Okay.
No one would say that.
All right. So if anyone has questions, please keep throwing questions at us. Oh, God damn you, Fast Car. Fast Car has asked very important and compelling first question. When will the question form request names first and question second, Kappa?
Never. Just because,
there
yeah.
We go, that's answered. Well, there we go. Answered. I believe the answer is basically fuck you.
I didn't know that was this was the, that kind of show.
Oh, it is. It is. Speaking of the Super Hornet, I was in the hangar looking at mine, and I noticed that if you get really close, the details such as rivets now look painted on. Have they reduced detail in order to improve performance? Don't get me wrong, I still think it looks great. From the original Grib.
The answer is probably, yeah. They're probably trying to get rid of as much of the unneeded geometry as they can. Simply because, I mean, Star Citizen ships already have an obscene number of polygons, but things like rivets, you don't really need to have geometry for.
I feel like there was a point where Chris was like, make this as detailed as you possibly can. And then they started doing things like having more than one ship in a room. And they were like, okay, let's find the sweet spot.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, God, things have moved. Oh, okay, this would be an interesting one. What do you all think Eris was doing when he saw an ATV that Spectrum Mobile is definitely coming from? He? Remus. That would be... He Remus. He did... Him and someone else had some thoughts and musings recently on Reddit giving to weapons and ships. I get the reference, but no.
Mm.
If someone else who's popular on the Reddits, check that out. But yeah, what do you think Eris was doing when he saw an ATV that Spectrum Mobile is definitely coming? Like, thoughts on Spectrum Mobile, I suppose. Let's go with that as a question.
Okay. Well, Eris is locked in a room fighting a moose.
Yeah, I was going to say, was he fighting a moose?
He'll watch ATV when he wins that battle. But in all seriousness, I was actually really happy to hear that they seem to have moved up mobile on their list of priorities. It seems to be their next big priority for Spectrum is mobile. I think it's super important, given that they're trying to compete with Discord for the community's attention. Discord works very well in mobile, so yeah.
I still say desktop should have been their first priority, not web, desktop, an app that replaces the launcher.
Yeah.
Yeah, fair enough. I think that's probably coming with the Delta launcher, though.
Yeah.
We should have ready one day sit down and talk about Spectrum and how CIG could approach attracting players to get off things like Mumble and Ventrilo and use built-in features. I mean, just having some, you know, nice things like a radio effect or players sounding like they're further away. That's nice and all, but that's not going to drag me away from voice over IP that I've already got and established. So, but that's a segue. Stormy of the Winters clan would like to know when Nakara's tie is, as he is the only one who doesn't have one.
Stormy better behave yourself. No, where's my tie? I don't have a tie on. I don't wear a tie on this stream. I wear Star Citizen merchandise, which is Squadron 42 shirt and Squadron 42 hoodie, and yeah.
No, to be completely fair, I don't have a tie on either. You're seeing things. So
he also isn't smoking at this particular moment, I don't think.
No. Nor am I floating in the vacuum of space.
This is a good thing, yes.
I was wondering how you were talking.
How he keeps the cigarette lit as well.
Yeah.
Stormy asks, what did everyone think of the Happy Hour live creature creation?
I loved it.
I only caught a little bit of it. It was really cool. It was
so good.
And then there was that one issue where they let's just say they seemed to have bugged out a little bit.
Yeah. Yeah, that was
spider crabs.
That was quite the yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I'm gonna be the contrarian here. While it was really enjoyable to watch, it was fun to watch. Design by committee is never a good thing in my
I actually like their idea on the stream. I love their idea on the stream where they would just create all the creatures they create on this stream all go on one planet.
That'd be really cool, actually.
And name the planet Derp.
Well, they were suggesting the name Nope.
See,
a planet called Nope, and it'd be filled with other crazy creations from the live stream.
Designing by committee, yes, is a bad idea when there's, like, you know, 10 to 20 people. But when you have an entire Twitch audience, it kind of makes it fun a little bit. Sure, you might not end up with something that's, like,
sure, it makes it fun.
Yeah.
It makes it fun, but you end up with stupid decisions like a nine-legged spider. That's stupid, and people picked it because it's stupid.
True.
Oh, wait, was that a ninth leg? Was that what that thing on the back was?
It was originally supposed to be, yes.
They changed it.
It's not a flight penis.
It became a stinger, which is what it's going to end up being.
Okay.
Ryan, I kind of hope that they pick it up next time and finish the design with that creature.
What they need to do is just come up with ideas that make sense, but they're, like, very different, and then have those voted upon rather than, like, just putting an open-ended question, like, how many legs should it have? And people are like, oh, put 42 because that's, like, the number, right? You know.
Because any audience of size, and especially the Twitch audience, if there is a ridiculous option, that's the option they will choose.
Yeah. That's why you should, like, put, like, have three options where, like, oh, how many legs should this bug have? 4, 6, or 8? And then they have to vote between those four or those three. I can count.
I'm really
bringing multiples of four. Yeah.
I do agree with that, but I thought it was a really good stream to watch. It was just great. Like, I've never really watched anyone create something live in ZBrush.
Yeah, and it was fascinating.
It was really impressive, yeah. And I definitely think they should keep doing it. I think that showing the game dev process live is very helpful for people to understand how much work goes into it. There's actually one thing that I would love for them to do that Paradox does. I was watching sort of during their development phase for Solaris, and every week they would basically take the newest version of their game and play it live on stream, even when it wasn't released to anyone else. And I don't know, it was really cool, and you could see sort of the game developer's take on everything that was happening inside the game, and that was kind of cool. So maybe as we get closer to release, we'll get them exploring the universe live on stream. One of the things that actually happened this week too that I wanted to mention is that they started putting some very interesting things in the vault. This week in the subscribers vault was some images of Daymar, which is a moon of Crusader. And this is how Daymar will appear in 3.0. I thought that was pretty interesting. It should be pretty cool once we actually get to see this in the game. I need 3.0. I did like their switch last week. They started putting more 3.0. Actually, a couple weeks ago, they started putting more 3.0 stuff in there. Last week was the Hurston vegetation work in progress. So that was really cool to see as well. I'm excited to see more of that stuff coming out.
Fastcat has just made the announcement that Star Citizen has broke $144 million in crowdfunding.
Woohoo!
Shiv, where's the crowd clapping sound effect?
I don't have the soundboard loaded.
Ah, okay.
Not going to lie, didn't think that far ahead. Getting over man flu still. Will punish self later. Now I've completely ruined my train of thought. Where was I? Curatus basically asked the same question. I'll come back to that one, Fast Cart. Which planet, and this is another Fast Cart question, everyone, you can all ask a question. Which planet should that spider that was made go on? Same planet as the sandworm.
No, I like Zane's idea. It was dirt, the dirt planet.
I don't know. I think it would go fine in that planet with the sandworm. Although it would be pretty. So I'm not sure how many people watched the dev stream, but that spider ended up being gigantic. I would love to see some sort of battle between a sandworm and that giant flying spider thing.
Oh, and like have
basically
the guy
we're
from,
turning this planet into Space Australia.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And have the guy from Galactic Gear narrate like the battle between it, like a Discovery documentary.
Exactly. Exactly.
Okay. Zhane, which planet do you think the spider giant creature with evil fangs and stinger should go? Same derp. Planet as the sandworm, or you're sticking with Derp?
Derp. Derp in the Nope system.
All right, Derp it is.
Awesome.
God, I love going to Nope this time of year. It's so beautiful.
Nope. Where are you off to? Nope. Questions seem to be slowing down, so I will have to ask this. I'm so sorry, everyone. Prepared for a long answer in advance. Will your next PC be Intel or AMD based and why?
Yay. Hold on. Can I skip out on this since I talked about it already for 30 minutes today?
Yes, you can.
Are you sure you want to? Because, I mean, you're the one. I'm not going to say it that way because I know exactly what Fastcart would say. We'll get to you last to answer the question.
Yes. I will add
and
on to what you guys
there
said.
There are no other questions.
Yeah.
Yes. Zhane, your thoughts? New AMD stuff, and what do you think?
I think competition is great. I think I have no brand allegiance to my PC components whatsoever, and when I have some money and decide to upgrade my computer, I will look at what is the best bang for the buck at the time. But, you know, competition in the marketplace is fantastic. I don't know anyone who wouldn't be for that.
Absolutely. Nehkara.
So, I do really like AMD as a company. Not sure how many people are familiar with Ryzen, but Ryzen is launching next week, which is, it's going to start with 3 processors and then move on to a whole bunch more later on. Sort of the big shocking thing about this is it looks like AMD, I mean, we don't know, and we will not know until we get actual benchmarks from real human beings. It looks like AMD has firmly managed to start competing with Intel again at a fraction of the cost, especially at the high end. The R7 1800X, which they're pinning against the 6900K, is half the price for the same performance. I'm going to go back to what Zhane said. Even if I decide to go with Intel, which I probably will go for an AMD system next. Even if I decide to go with Intel, it looks like AMD is going to drive down prices, which is awesome for consumers. And it also looks like we're finally going to get decent. It looks like we might finally get more 8-core CPUs and get away from the dual cores completely. I think that hopefully that will push game developers into actually utilizing more cores. Mm-hmm. And
that was actually one of AMD's reasonings for having more cores, is they're seeing the rise in using more cores for stuff like that.
That was beautiful.
Yeah. Oh, I didn't do that. I totally did that on purpose. The Ryzen. Yeah.
I'm actually
getting to the core of the matter.
We really don't know enough about Vega yet to tell you whether or not I'm going to get one, but my my plan in the back of my head is to build a Ryzen Vega computer probably this summer. By the way, Vega, we will learn a lot more in 3 days. They have a big thing at GDC, AMD does, and they're going to be releasing a whole bunch of details about Vega, which Same is their Nvidia. Next generation.
NVIDIA's yeah. having a big well, thing soon.
They played chicken at CES, which was just hilarious.
Yeah, you're not going to do AMD, anything.
Yeah, basically. AMD was like, oh, we're going to talk about Vega, but then NVIDIA came out and basically said nothing, so... Then AMD didn't say anything, so...
Tangentially to that, didn't they see something that Star Citizen is appearing with, like, the Lumberyard booth at GDC?
Absolutely. Yeah, they're... Star Citizen CIG will be at the Lumberyard booth all week, which is from the 27th to March 3rd. And they will be on the 24-hour live stream for Amazon Lumberyard, which is on Wednesday. It sounds like they have a half-hour slot in there. And then there will also be interviews with the devs throughout the week. So expect to see some interesting stuff coming out of GDC.
Cool.
Yep.
Codesmith asks, and I love the way he's asked this. I have to ask it. Uh-oh. So you think the crotch spider should be followed through development on a weekly basis, showing the various disciplines accomplishing their tasks with it until it is in the game in 3 to 4 months. What are your thoughts on crotch spiders?
Oh, I mean... They're crotch spiders.
I had stomach spiders once. It wasn't good.
That does sound unpleasant.
Very.
Nitro?
I don't know. The whole thing makes me crabby.
That's very shellfish of you.
Wow. Okay. So, to actually answer the question.
Please.
I would actually think that would be a really cool thing is for them to follow this one creature through all of its like various iterations to actually become a creature in the game. So like seeing them do final modeling and then animation and so on and so forth. That's just my opinion. I think it would be really cool, but we'll see what they do with it.
Stormy, who is Mistress of Fiction over at Relay, by the way. Who is excited for updated ship stats with ongoing regular updates?
Apparently Stormy is.
I mean, I feel like I've heard that before. Correct me if I'm wrong.
Several times, I believe.
They've tried to do this before. Hopefully they're successful this time.
We shall see. I mean, I suppose they could have a way to automate it if they have, yeah, but that's irrelevant. They could have a way to automate it so it's no longer someone needs to go in there and manually do it. You know, part of Spectrum is having these things in a database, so it could automatically be done that way. I guess, maybe, probably not.
I mean, at the very least, an update on all the stats and a spruced up stats page is not a bad thing. I do hope they actually keep up with the stats, though, because I know some people are really, really interested in that part of it.
Dana asks, anyone play Helion, and what do you think of it?
It looks good. I haven't played it, but it looks good.
And what the Helion is it?
I didn't play it, but I watched, actually watched Bad News Baron play it yesterday, I think. And it looked... early, but it looked good. The internal components of the ship that he was in looked like kind of what I hope Star Citizen will be at some point. It was very indicative of that kind of like running around from part to part inside your ship and repairing things and it looked good. It looked super early though. You know, it needs a ton of work.
It reminds me a lot of Space Engineers, but if you took out the building aspect and kind of added in like the almost RPG-ish type aspect of Star Citizen's planning to be, and that kind of mixed together. I mean, it might just be because it, aesthetically, the animations and the models and stuff just seem very Space Engineers-y to me. So.
Yeah.
But I, I gotta I have to note, right when this question was asked, my Steam notification came up that said Papa Dolvac is playing Hellion.
Why don't you go ahead and ask him what the Hellion it is?
I could do that.
Fastcar asks, are you hoping there'll be more crowdsourced happy hours like yesterday? What asset would you like to see crowdsourced? Armor, ship, a planet?
Armor.
Because a planet. A big, round, and planety.
Armor. Either the Titan armor or more of the heavy outlaw armor that we saw in ATV. Because that thing looked awesome.
Yeah, it sure did.
As much as I derided like the whole design by committee thing, which I still have an issue with, it was infinitely more fun to watch than them playing Arena Commander.
Yeah. Well, I mean, Pry01 or however you pronounce his name said earlier, just don't have Disco Lando make the options for the Krauss, because he purposely makes weird options. So, yes.
Okay, so I've heard back from the Dolvac.
Mm.
His opinion on Hellion is it's really cool when it works. It's jank as fuck at the moment, but they've already put out two patches in under 24 hours. So there you go.
I love Dolvac.
That does sound exactly like Dolvac. Yeah, we miss Dolvac. Code Smythe, I don't know. What is your guess as to when the first PTU version of 3.0 will come out?
What year is it? 2017? Like, I don't know, 2020? I guess.
Which will come first, 3.0 or the new South Park game?
Yes. See, if I underestimate them, then I can't be disappointed, right?
See, at the end of last year, and like nothing has happened in the interim to change my guess, but my guess has changed for some reason. I don't know why, but like I would have said, oh, it'll be like March. But no, it's no.
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 So, first of all, I want to actually answer the last question. I would really like to see them do a planet live on stream. I think that'd be really cool. Like, not a whole planet, obviously. They couldn't do a whole planet. Kinda, but like an hour of them. An hour. Yeah, exactly. Just more of what they did at CitizenCon.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I love that stuff, and an hour of that would be so cool. So yes, please, that. And I mean, there's only like 400 or 500 planets they have to build, so
yeah,
plus moons. Should be no problem. Now on to the question we were actually on. May.
Okay.
May?
That'd be
wrong. Yeah, for Evocati.
I saw a poll with this question being asked on Reddit a few days ago, and it surprised me how pessimistic the, I mean, it shouldn't because it's Reddit, but it surprised me how that the leading answer was Gamescom. Mm. Like, that's problematic.
I mean,
it really depends how they plan on approaching it. Like, if 2.6.2 is the last patch before 3.0, then, well, May. If they do a 2.7 patch to test subsumption, which it sounds like they're thinking about, then it might be more like July or August. I don't know.
Summer's looking increasingly likely, I think.
I think it'll drop on July 16th as a birthday present to me.
Wait, what? Oh, wow. Your birthday is the same as my niece's.
I am your niece.
Well, that makes a lot of sense.
I just it sound different.
Makes sense.
That explains so much.
I just sound different over the internet.
Hi, Uncle Nehkara.
So... the one thing that I want to prepare people for, though, 3.0 is going to need a lot of time on Evocati and PTU. There, it's in like, it's almost not even a patch. Like, this patch will be bigger than the entire game itself, plus many times that.
Yeah, like, a lot of people are probably equating it to the patching process we had between 1.7 or 8 between 2.0 And while that was a big leap for Star Citizen, this is, like, if not equal, much, much bigger.
Much bigger. Like, between Subsumption, which is, like, the entire basis for the AI and mission system, and the professions, cargo, mining, bounty hunting, all of that, plus the entire star system, plus all the cities and all of the way that all of the NPCs work, and plus all of the other aspects, it's an enormous patch. So
it's not a patch, it's a game.
And I would expect it to be on PT on Evocati for maybe a month, and then the PTU for maybe another month or even two. It's going to be a long time to go between their first testing and actual release, in my opinion.
Yeah, hopefully they'll approach it slower than they did with 2.0. Because, I mean, granted, 2.0 was, they were trying to push it out before Christmas. It went out to PTU, and then like 2 weeks later it went to live, and it was janky, to say the least. And so hopefully with 3.0, they're like, all right, there's a lot here. Let's stay on PTU as long as we possibly can.
I want to give him a shout out though for 2.6.1. It is really stable. Yeah. I was really impressed by that. And I think they're going to try and maintain that stability as much as they can, but I think 3.0 is going to be pretty unstable when it gets to PTU. That's going to take them a while to iron out. It's a lot of new game systems there, guys.
Yeah, well, I haven't played 2.6.1 yet, but 2.6 blew me away with how fluid it felt compared to, 2.5. So
it's even better now. Like, they've done a really good work. I do think that I admit fully that I think 3.0 is a ways away. I do think that they're starting to go this direction, but they need to start showing more of it because that's what people are interested in.
Yeah.
And it's really also, there's so much to show. It's an enormous thing. You could easily show stuff about it every week and not run out of content.
Now, do you think maybe it's going a bit slower because they're trying to focus more on Squadron 42? Or?
I think they're separate teams for the most part. Because most of the PU development is in the United States, and most of Squadron 42 is in Europe. However, that is definitely an aspect of it. I really think that they need... I shouldn't say need. I think it's a very, very good idea for them to get Squadron out the door this year. Yes. We got kind of an indication with that, though. I mean, they're getting pretty close to finishing the uniform for the deck crew for Squadron 42. That's not like a core fundamental thing that you work on. Mm-hmm. It's pretty. Right. That's a detail.
Yeah.
But of course, the other problem with Squadron is we really have no idea where it's at because we haven't seen it in the 15, 16 months now.
Yeah,
we're not really. I mean, the Morrow Tour was the last time we saw it.
Mm-hmm.
So we've got time enough for one last quick question from Rock and Anchor. Great name. Do you think that we will see planets with rainforest and giant trees where we can capture wild animals and smuggle them out and maybe climb a tree?
Yes.
Yeah.
Tree climbing, maybe not tree climbing. That maybe not, but planets with huge forests where you can capture wild animals? Yeah, because they've talked about doing all those things already.
Now, can I take these wild animals and say encapsulate them in some sort of small spherical transportation device and then train them to fight for me and unleash them on other wild animal trainers who have their own things that they've caught? Is that
that's Pokemon in space. It's going to be an expansion to Pokemon Go.
Okay.
Yes. That's what the Aurora's use is.
Oh, that's going to be Spectrum 2.0, being able to catch wild animals on your phone on the go. You have to actually like walk around to the different places to catch them, too.
Kill me now.
Right. The other thing I wanted to mention... Oh, sorry, Jeff.
No, please.
This just came up to mind, but I think actually you might see salvage move up as well as mining, because they did mention a couple weeks ago that the Reclaimer is now in active production with two teams working on it.
Yes.
And given that it's their only salvage ship, I think you're going to see it sooner rather than later.
Reclaimer. Yes.
Yeah.
My favorite ship. I don't even own one. I just want to see
it. I love the Reclaimer.
I can't wait.
Mm-hmm. Any final thoughts, anyone?
No.
No.
Nitro?
Huh? No.
No? Right. Zhane, tell us where we can catch you around the Star Citizen community, please.
Oh, you can occasionally find me over at the base. I have a show called Space Debris, which is now on Friday evenings from 6 to 8 p.m. Eastern Time. Or occasionally 6 to 7 p.m. Eastern Time when this guy named Shiver takes over 1 week a month. you can find The Base at thebase.sc or twitch.tv/thebaseradio. And if for some reason you would want to follow me on Twitter, where I tweet about The Base and Star Citizen and like professional wrestling and liberal politics, I'm weird. You can follow me at Zhane1138. Really. Yeah, pretty much. Zhane1138, ZHANE1138.
Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you. Nitro.
Yes.
TyPat.
Yes.
Inventor of the TyPat.
Mm-hmm.
Where can we find you around the Star Citizen community?
You can find me. No, I was really tempted to do an Arnold Schwarzenegger there. No, you can find me over the base.
I thought you were having a stroke.
Only sometimes. You can find me over the base .sc as well. I do a show on Saturday mornings at 11 a.m. Eastern or 4 o'clock UTC. I also do two other shows with Shiv. One on the first Friday of the month now at 7 p.m. Eastern, midnight UTC, and another one at the same time on Wednesdays every week, which is Postcards from the Event Horizon, which just, I don't, that one's just. But
I don't recommend it.
Yeah.
I don't recommend it.
Usually it's awesome. It's described as what the fuck.
If you consider yourself a masochist, go ahead and check that show out.
I'm on it.
Yeah. Sometimes. Yeah, but you're the only sane one.
Yeah, well, yeah.
Other than that,
Nehkara.
Gosh, Shiv, interrupting me. Jeez, no. you can follow me on Twitter at NitroTypeAt. I tweet about things sometimes and stuff. Now you can introduce the space boat.
Thanks. Nehkara, where can we find you around the Star Citizen community?
Well, I only lurk the subreddit like all day, every day. Really my home is relay.sc. And I post lots of news and some articles. I put up an article last week that I was really proud of. I did lots of work on that one. It is really interesting. I actually caught this little piece out of ATV last week, which was them showing us their internal star map for Stanton. And what I realized what it was showing was that it was actually showing the map of materials and resources required to produce the Moby glass. So I went into depth about that and about what the map was actually showing us. So go check that out. It's over on relay.sc. And
you write good fiction.
I do occasionally write some fiction, more so actually lately. So also check that out on relay.sc. And you can also find me on Twitter, although I don't tweet a ton. You can find me on Twitter at Nehkara.
You're looking for article writers at the moment, are you not?
Absolutely, but more to the point, I'm actually trying to get some topics out to my existing team. I think we have one. I put a topic out this week. Fourth Oracle is going to be doing an article on some of the things that we saw on ATV this week, and then I'm going to get Zhane to work as well.
Oh,
excellent! I think Stormy is also looking for any fiction writers out there. So if you have any fiction that you wouldn't mind other people reading, submit it to Stormy and she'll look it over. And if you can take criticism, because she'll give you criticism, go from there. I have, oh God, yeah, we're doing the Faux Friday Night Show next week now, aren't we?
Yep,
I believe so.
So we've got that on next week, Postcards, Dead Air will be back. I think that's it for me. God.
And I can't promise anything, but we heard rumors that Eris was close to victory and he may be returning to our realm.
Is that what you heard? Yeah. I heard he died.
Well, shit, rumors fly, don't they?
And I thought I was almost done.
We'll find out soon enough.
Oh, thank you very much for joining us. Keep an eye out at relay.sc. We'll see you next week.